this talk is about modules and Java linker. I think pretty much about modules have been covered. I'll take this opportunity to cover it very briefly once again and cover some important points about it. And also the new tool Java linker. It's like the, it became like, it's the de facto standard for creating Java JDK images now. I'll just cover it slightly here. And I'm Bhanu Prakash. I work for Java platform team, Oracle. Okay, this is the agenda. I'll slightly cover about modules. Again, module dependencies, this is some stuff. And then JLink and packaging. This talk is not about the code, actual code constructs or something like that, but it's more about the way JDK 9 impacts the development environment, be it writing the code, testing, deploying, configuring, all those configurations actually. All those things this talk is all about. And I will also introduce you JLink plugins, some of the built-in plugins and some of them which are shipped with JDK 9. I will also cover them. Yeah, this is a regulatory statement. Don't make any recent decisions based on this. Okay. Jigsaw. I think some of the problems we have seen earlier. Still JDK 8, maybe in special cases, otherwise, right, JDK had been a single monolithic image, and it had been a problem since long time. I mean, be it embedded devices or cloud-based platforms, the space is very important there, right? I think in JDK 8, it had a tool called JRE Create, but that is for embedded JDK, I'll cover it later. But otherwise, it was single monolithic image. It was a big problem there. And then, the class path or jar hell. The way, like any moderate or big applications, right, they will have a number of jars and the dependencies among the jars is not properly specified and it would lead to lots of problems, something like sharding of the classes or maybe, like the discovery of the classes itself. You may frequently encounter no class definition found errors, something like that. Some of these problems have been addressed by Maven by using the static number of jars and then versioning and all those things. But still, if you are a normal development environment, right, you still face all these problems there. And then the performance. Performance side, two aspects, startup and security. I mean, JDK being a single image, right, JDK was like either JDK for developers or JRE for runtime, right? Any moderate application had to be like even in a small application, right, had to ship the entire JDK to the customers, and then it would lead to problems like download. I have to download the entire image. The JIT doesn't work. If the entire image is not there, and also some other problems like startup being slow. Maybe that is because the discovery process itself, even the Java version command, right, it requires maybe some 300 classes to load actually. Well, these are all existing problems, and some of them are solved using Jigsaw. First one is modularization. This is, I would say, a significant and disruptive change in JDK 9, if not phenomenal. I think the users have to say that phenomenal, but it's a disruptive change. Be it modules has been introduced as programming first class citizens, again programming construct as like classes and packages. Modules have been introduced now. There is a specific dependencies. You can mention what a module is all about. I mean, like, you can package certain set of packages in a module, and you can mention what the module requires and what it exports, all those stuff. And it solves the problem of class path. I mean, by the way, right, when you mention lots of jars in a class path, right, you are really not saying which jar is dependent on other jar. It's like a mesh, actually. It's all dependencies are a mesh. You cannot see. It's hard to say which jar takes a preference, or hard to see, like, two jars have same fully qualified class name, then it's again a problem. All these problems, right? This class path has been replaced with module path and module dependencies and a specific structure to address these problems. And performance and startup. I mean, performance, right? Startup. I would explain more about startup in the coming slides when I talk about JLink plugins. But since JDK now allows to build custom images, right, some of the things can be pre-computed, such as something like system module graph, and then those things can be used for decreasing the startup time and also the performance aspects. I mean, like download, you can download the dependencies, incremental downloads is quite possible. Maybe I should use this one. Module is a collection of, is a collection of classes and data. It's again a collection of packages, maybe you can say like that. And modules have an important construct called, I mean, like it's called module descriptor. It has visibility rules about the modules. I mean, what a module does, like it does some activity and it requires some dependencies and it tries to export some aspects. Some programming like classes or something like that. Okay. This is one important aspect in when modules was introduced. Accessibility. Accessibility is like, okay, with JDK and modules, right, programmer have now an opportunity to hide some of the things or maybe make the changes local to the module and to expose parts which public requires actually. You can see the statement there. Public no longer means accessible. When you say a class is public, it doesn't mean the class is accessible from outside. It's a simple name application that I used here. Confur app is an application, is a module. It is dependent on another module, Confur bot, and it has read functionality on that. It has read dependency on that. It's a read edge, but it is reading only some parts of it. Okay, now in summary, right, when you make a class public, that alone is not enough for your class to be utilized outside. So a class has to be public, and the corresponding module descriptor should specify that as an export package, under the export package, and the dependent modules, right, they should mention that as a require, under the require category. So all these three things should be satisfied to make the module to make a class really public. And this VM checks, I mean, this accessibility is made very strict now. I would say right from the compile time and even the runtime, even the VM, even all those, like it's imposed everywhere now, this accessibility rules. So even the regular Java reflection, right, it may not work unless you expose a package. And this is an important change. It disallows some of the programming constructs that were available earlier to the programmers, and those they cannot use. Programmers maybe like something like SunMix, some SunCom internal packages, something like that. But okay, for JDK 9, right, there is a hack that the JDK team has provided, which you can use for now for JDK 9 to utilize internal packages. Like something like it is called as add exports. Any questions around this? I think if there is any key takeaway, right? Maybe this is the slide. Okay, this is a small app. Confu app is dependent on it's a custom module, another module, Confu board, and the same module is dependent on java.sql. How their module declarations looks like is like Confu app, you can see that there is an requires clause here, requires java.sql, and the bar, the Confu bar is the base, is like a independent module, it just exports the Confu bar package there. Clear? Okay. This is the actual module dependencies. Though I have just declared that Confu app requires only two modules, actual module dependency graph looks like this. All the modules by implicitly dependent on java.base, and you can see here Confu app is dependent on java.sql, but java.sql is utilizing two more modules there, java.xml and java.logging. Okay. Then how Confu, the main app, right? How is it able to use it? That is with the use of exports public. Exports public, maybe I'll cover it later. This is another construct in module info Java file, which says that when a module says exports public, the dependent modules get those packages as free, actually, all those modules as free to the users. Yeah, this is the transitive dependencies. The conf app is dependent on java.logging indirectly. It's like a transitive, A depends on B, B depends on C. That is because java.sql internally is using some logger API, which the conf app doesn't use. Yeah, this is there's immense amount of effort has been went into JDK 9 modularization. I mean, the platform itself has to support now. Unlike earlier, right? With embedded JDK and all, it was a different case actually. They just provided compact profiles and all. But now with the platform itself he's supporting inherently this feature modules, and you can see the modules module graph here. Some edges are missing here, but can you make any, like, do you make any conclusions on this graph? I mean, anything, any points to note here? There is edges here, everything is leading here. I would say that is missing. Any guess? I mean, what does it say? What does the graph say? I mean, there are lots of packages. And all the packages are dependent on java.base. This is required for any basic JDK image. And graph is acyclic. Is it? Okay, graph is acyclic. Module graph should not have any cyclics. It should be acyclic in nature. I mean, there should not be any cycles within the dependencies. That is one conclusion you can make. Any questions till now? I mean, is it clear? Going well? Okay. Okay, I think this stuff was covered earlier in the earlier sessions, actually, how to compile modules and how to generate modules, basically. It's like normal Java command we use, and it's normal Java program compilation, except that you pass module.info class name, Java file name as part of the Java command. And one additional thing to note here is when you are compiling the main module, right, you'll have to mention module path here. In the module path, you'll mention the path indicates where the dependent modules can be found, actually. Mods. And there is another way you can compile multiple modules at a stretch. I mean, in a single shot, it is called as module source path. Using this option, you can compile multiple modules in a single command. And maybe I'll just go through the example I have before I jump in. This is the small app, Confu app. This is one module. You can see the module info file here. It requires confu bar. Are you able to see? It's very short, right? Maybe I'll just show you here. I have the same thing in the slide also. Okay. When we do jmod describe on these modules, right? For example, the standalone module confu bar, you get this output. This clearly says that this particular module requires certain modules, and this exports certain modules, certain packages, basically. Sorry. And can you see the requires mandated java.base here. This was not part of the module info file, but still it came up here. This was actually, this gets added up by the bytecode interpreter. I'll just run through that. This is my example. I have modules here. Confu app and Confu bar. My Java version is, build 9, JDK 9, version 9, build 131. It's like 2 weeks old build. What I would do is just jmod. this is the output. This particular app, this particular module, right, it requires ConfEngine module, and it requires a mandated java.base. Though it was not there in the module info, it came here. I mean, it is being inserted during the compilation time. And then it requires java.sql because the example uses some SQL JDBC statements. And then it conceals the actual package, actual module. I mean, I don't export anything outside. I mean, okay. There is another option in Java. I mean, in the Java command, right? It has been enhanced to display the module discovery path. Actually, it's called -x diagnostic resolver. When you add this option to the Java command, right? It shows all the way module discovery happens. I mean, how individual modules are read and the order of the discovery. This is like a debugging purposes. Okay. I'll go with the linking. Linking. Okay. JLink, before I jump into JLink, right, I will just cover a brief history about jre create that was added in JDK 8. As I said, Java image had been like monolithic image, either JDK or JRE, but JDK 8 had a provision actually to create a shrinked compact size of JDK images called using profiles actually, compact profile, compact one profile, compact two profile. Compact one profile was something around 11 MB. Compact two profile was maybe like 23 MB, something like that. Till JDK 7 or maybe JDK 8 also, right? Oracle ships the actual JDK images for the target platforms. So let's say Linux, Mac, all those stuff, all those operating systems. But with JDK 8, right, especially embedded JDK, it actually shipped the JRE create tool, which developers can use it to create the actual JDK. This was an attempt by Oracle to shrink the JDK image size, but it would still pick up the jars selectively, but that doesn't mean that you will get all you require. I mean, it gets you all you require, but you also get something which you don't require. It was not so that support was not there. So JLink, as part of JEP 282, right, JLink was implemented. JLink started as a small command line utility to generate runtime images for the developers, but soon it became a de facto standard. Actually, I mean, even the JDK images generated the binaries. I mean, like the regular JDK images also use this command now on day-to-day basis, and it has lots of options. And this is actually, this plugin is at a very very nice spot, I would say. You might know actually Java command is supposed to be dumb. I mean, it generates bytecodes for a given class files. It's supposed to not to do any optimizations there, because it has to adhere to some spec, and then it has to generate the bytecode as verbose as possible. But when the application is run actually, right, then optimizations actually trigger, maybe the JIT compiler or any optimizations for that matter ahead of compilation now. But all those optimizations incur cost actually. It takes lots of computation power and all. So JLink, right, this tool is in a very lucrative space where it provides an opportunity to do some more optimizations just after the compilation. We have all the class files, all the jar files for related to the application, and before creating an image in that space actually. So JLink, as said in the spec, right, link time is an opportunity to do whole world optimizations that are otherwise difficult at compile and costly at runtime. And best part about this is it exposes API, so developers can write their own plugins, and it also ships like 12 built-in plugins, so developers can use them and also extend the existing plugins to improve the functionality. This is the regular JDK image you would see. You'll have bin jre lib, and within jre bin lib, right? This is the regular up to JDK 8. This has been the image structure, right? But with JDK 9, the image structure is going to be just bin conf. There is nothing like jre. There is no rt.jar. There is no tools.jar. All those things have been removed. It's like plain directory of bin conf and lib. Lib will have the modules there. So JLink, as shown in the figure, it takes group of modules and packages into a runtime image. That's the actual functionality of JLink. I mean, so the command is simple. It takes output as need to mention the output file name and add mods. In the add mods, you mention the root module's name. That's the main module name that you are trying to compile or trying to cap. Package and the module path where you will mention the dependent module names. I'll just create it quickly. Minus output, maybe say ES101 minus add mars. App, this is my main module, Confu app. And the mods. Module path. Module path is where dependent modules can be discovered. This is the path where it searches basically. This is mods, and then in Windows the modules has to be separated by semicolon. That's it. That's it. It generated a JDK image with my own modules. I mean, like the two modules that I mentioned. I just go inside that. This is the simple directory structure: bin, conf, lib. It has only essential, very essential things here. If I go to lib, right? The modules, the majority of the JDK image size is contributed by modules, and this is like 29 MB now. Modules is the package, is a packaged modules actually. Basically, all the modules are packaged into this this file, and this is like 29 MB. If you look at the original JDK 9 image, right? It was something like 153 MB. It has come down to 29 MB, but we can shrink it further. Okay. And the best part about this generated image is that all the modules are now known actually. I mean, the module graph is pre-generated. System module graph is pre-generated. So when I say bin/java list mods, it shows me all the packaged modules within this JDK. Confu app, Confu bar, and JDK. Okay. And then it's also quite simple to run the main program now. I just say Java minus CM. Main. That's it. If you remember in the earlier slides, I mentioned that if there are any dependent modules, we need to mention an additional option called module path. So you don't need to mention now actually, because this is a generated image created out of those modules. So you don't have to mention those module path here. You just mention minus m. This is the main program name. That's it. Or maybe this is the app2 where I am using JDBC program here. Yeah, this is some known exception. Because I don't have those drivers and all. Yeah. But yeah, this is how you invoke. It's quite easy to invoke those Java programs now. OK, can see here, when I do list mods, it listed all the modules properly in orderly fashion, and then running is quite simple. It just Java minus M and the main program name here. And no module path is required. Okay, plugins. Plugins work in two phases actually. While, see, here is an opportunity where you have like lots of classes packaged as modules. Plugins provide an opportunity where you can, they work in two places actually. While going through all those individual modules, and you have an opportunity to go through in each of those classes and do some optimizations there. And also the second part is you can add additional information, meta information to the image. Those are the two things. And then you can see like JDK itself has some 12 built-in plugins, and you can use any of these, or you can also extend. I mean, like you can also write your own custom plugins. And another best part is like it provides all the all these things programmatically. You can extend these things programmatically, and this all these plugin APIs is experimental. I mean, they are subject to change, but you can experiment. You can still use it. As I said, this is like the workflow. In the left-hand side, top right, you'll see like lots of modules there. And you say it's like a grinding machine. It goes through all the modules, individual class files. And then you have an opportunity to remove some class files or modify, instrument some class files, etc. You can all do all those things. Wherever cross marks are there, right, you can write plugins there actually. And the image creation part, you can add some meta information, or you can do additional compression, all those things. In like internal study, right, it was found that this jimage was able to string maybe like 5 times more than the regular jar image, regular jar compression compared to regular jar compression. I'll just show you some of those results also. Optimizing, this is one plugin. Here we will talk about system module descriptors plugin. Since when generating a JDK image, right, custom image, you know the modules the program is going to access, the system module graph is pre-generated. And it is generated using a system module descriptors plugin. Actually, this plugin came out of a need actually. The need was that after implementing Jigsaw and all, right, the startup time actually went up. I mean, it increased compared to JDK 8. So that was a big problem. So what they found is that a significant amount of time was spent in just parsing the module.info files and locating the modules and discovery part, basically. So this plugin was written, and this worked out well, actually. It showed some 50% decrease in the time required for startup. And also, it improved lots of performance actually, and also it reduced the memory usage. Also, you can see this is the some of the results. This red bar matters actually. This is the user time where when the command started and when the command end. It's like 50% decrease in the more than 50% decrease in the startup time. I mean, and this plugin was identified an essential plugin. It is enabled by default, actually. If there is a reason for you to disable, then only you can disable it. Otherwise, it's enabled by default. So you can tweak this setting using this option, installed modules option. Okay. I cannot show you demo of the system modules descriptor plugin because it's all in milliseconds. So please excuse me. And the compress plugin. This is again. Actually, this works in three levels. Level zero is about string sharing plugin. String sharing plugin is like, see, we all know about jar files, right? It's like nothing but zip files with additional meta-inf file, and that was all the compression that JDK was using till now, actually. But with introduction of Jigsaw and then with introduction of plugins, right, it provided an opportunity, a window where we can do some more optimization on those individual class files, actually. So this string sharing plugin, right, actually what it does is it goes through all the class files in the modules, and it extracts the UTF-8 strings, and it creates the global strings table and references the elsewhere, actually. I mean, like it's used elsewhere, even including the Java-based module classes. this itself resulted in lots of decrease in the actual image size generated. And with level two, right? With level two, you will include both these plugins, string sharing plugin and zip plugin. Zip plugin is the normal jar plugin, the normal zip formatting. This works on the class as a whole, but it doesn't look into the class data as well as such. But string sharing plugin, it optimizes the data. So these are the sizes. I mean, if the compression was not there, it was like 28 MB. With level zero, it was like 17 MB. With level two, it came down to like 11.5 MB actually. Or maybe I can just quickly do that. Just regenerate the image with compression on. Much time. 102. It has, you can see here it has come down to 13 MB here. Earlier it was like 29 MB, if I remember correctly. It was 29 MB in the without compression, and now it is like 13 MB now. And this is not all. We can add few more command line arguments to JLink tool, which does further compression actually. Something like when I was doing experimentation, like some more additional arguments like strip debug statements, include locales. There are some more plugins. I mean, like some more additional options. The size comes down significantly after that. This is another minor, very small plugin. This might be useful when you are delivering JDK image, your own custom JDK image, you want to add your own release information to the JDK image. I'll just show a demo of that. It's quite simple. I just come here. By default, right, any JDK image has a file, text file called release. It just has, it has information about the OS version, OS version architecture and Java version, all this stuff. And we can add any more information we want here. Maybe quickly, I'll just add some more information here. Release info. There is an option to add some information. You can also remove some existing information. Maybe I'll just add some information. Source equal to EclipseSummit'16. Oh, sorry, I would have used a different image name here. That's it, you have a JDK image with all the new information. I just go here and just type. Where is the source? You can see here, source. This has this got appended to the existing release info file. I would say that along with the other contents, it has added some more extra contents to that. Like this may be useful for any custom runtime images, right? You may want to add some more additional information about the licenses or maybe build numbers, etc. These are some of the plugins. In summary, right, JDK 9 is an important change. I mean, it's been described as a significant change. The accessibility checks have been made much more stricter. The accessibility checks are now implemented at the at the runtime, even at the VM level. So there are more restrictions actually. Now the code can be more secure. It also improves the usability, maintenance wise also. It's easy for the developers. And simply upgrading to JDK 9 like it depends. It depends actually. Migrating to JDK 9 from JDK 8, like JDK 8 projects, right? It depends on how you have written the code. If you are using safe constructs and programming guidelines, requested programming guidelines and things, right? It's not that hard actually. I mean, like you can do it at your own pace, except the dependencies though. You may be using some extra jar files, so those jar files also need to be modularized. Either you can do it, or you can just wait for those tools to come up with those modules. But it's like there is an easy way to turn a jar file into a module. So there are required plugins, I mean required utilities there. And yeah, some libraries may require changes. And more importantly, right, JDK 9 will also may affect the build processes actually, deployment and build things are happening. It might affect there because it's different now. I mean, like the regular class paths may not work. You need to there's some learning curve in dealing with module paths and all. But yeah, but you will have some rewards also. Yeah, that is all I have. I don't know. I exceeded my time. I'm ready for questions. Have any questions on, in general, I mean, modularization or maybe any JDK 9 features? I have my colleague Vaibhav also here. Maybe you can ask anything. Yeah, this is some of the important mailers. This is an open JDK mailer. Anybody can subscribe. I see frequently actually many college interns, right, even they send mails to JDK 9 devs requesting like additional information, how to use this and that. And it's a very active mailer groups. So don't hesitate to ask any questions, it may be trivial, be it so, but you can still ask. Have any questions in general? I think maybe, if I'm not wrong, maybe I think 20%, at least 20% of the people have used JDK 9 here, right? I think maybe. I know many of the speakers have been using it, JDK 9 has tried, but maybe I know actually many community, right? I see like there is some nervousness actually upgrading to 9 because things might break and may not work completely. And yeah, there is another important aspect. Maybe I will answer this question actually for you. Versioning, this was deliberately ignored actually in modules because it was identified as a bigger problem than to solve than the modules itself. So there is nothing like you can mention version name in the modules. So you cannot have multiple modules with the same name basically. Any more questions? And I think there was one question. I'm like, there was, it was in the other session actually, but maybe I'll try to answer here. Maybe if you are like a container writer, right? You are deploying multiple web apps. You has container manage multiple web apps there, right? And each of the web app may be using different versions of the same jar file. Then how do we handle such case? Modules as itself doesn't allow versioning to specify version information, and JDK just comes out if it sees modules with same name. I mean, any module with the same name, right? So there is another concept called layers. You can define a layer of class loaders actually. This is on top of the boot class loader. Can define layer of class loaders which can confine the modules to one particular application, and then can use extend that way. Yep. Though I'm not the right person, but all I could say is highly may not happen actually, but the command line tool is as powerful as that. Programmatic API itself is only experimental actually. even the, if you see that slides, right, even the modules image that is generated, right, the format is kept completely confidential, actually. You cannot access, you cannot use any tools to browse through that modules file. There is a way called, JRTFS, actually, is a file system API. You can use those file system API to go through those, all the list of modules and all. That is the only way, mechanism to access the modules directly. Anything? Done. Thank you. Thank you for your time.